to lunch. Hi, once again. Lovely. I've had a long travel. In fact, I've come from Bombay, I've landed in Delhi, and then I took another flight from Delhi to Sri Lanka. It's been a long flight, I must confess. I know we have a representative of the ARC here. You're doing a great job, ma'am, I must confess. Pehle road team worker se yahan road hain, which is quite commendable actually. So earlier you used to have cows and buffaloes which functioned as traffic policemen on East Delhi roads. I stayed in East Delhi when I was a journalist earlier. Great. So I got a call last evening to come and speak to you guys, and I was really not sure about what to speak, honestly. In fact, I was unsure till this morning, till I got into the airport lounge of Mumbai. Okay? And there was a gentleman who was having a conversation with another gentleman. And he says, yaar, maine smoke nahi ki aaj. So this other gentleman like, to kya hua? He like, pressure nahi aaya. I don't smoke, okay? But I still don't understand how is one activity which is detrimental to your respiratory system going to assist another activity of your excretory system. A part of me hopes that he will say at some point he's just joking. You know, and that sort of defined the theme for today's conversation here. I'm a stand-up comedian. You guys would have seen a lot of stand-up acts, right? If you guys want to catch up a stand-up act, you go to Canvas Club from here, in Noida, everybody else. But today I'm going to tell you the story behind stand-up comedy and the story behind writing a joke. Every time you see us saying just joking, go beyond the joke. The real story lies beyond what we say. We are performing artists, so we try and make our material as interesting and as funny as possible, but there are larger, deeper experiences that we have behind all these jokes, right? So that's largely what I'm going to talk to you guys about. Were you guys expecting a stand-up comedy performance today by any chance? Yes. Great, I won't disappoint you. I'm coming to Noida again next week. 754 tickets, please. Houseful. Yeah. But a TEDx talk cannot be a stand-up comedy performance because you guys will put it up on out on YouTube and possibly I'll lose all the possible revenues that I could earn from this content, yeah? Okay, so I'll briefly tell you a little bit about the psychology of joke writing actually. Yeah, I put out my first video a year ago which was on discrimination faced by folks in the Northeast. I'll give you a quick background of why I chose discrimination as a topic. That video is close to a million views, thankfully. I generally get a round of applause at this point in time, but great. No problem, this is Delhi. That's just the way I get the applause and record this part, and like, see, I have a lot of standing ovation for this. But no, so that video has done largely well, not because the jokes were funny. I would want to believe the jokes are funny, but I feel there was a larger relationship and record out there. Because the country, as diverse as ours, there's the potential of these variations being subjected to discrimination. I am from Uttar Pradesh. But I've lived all my life in Meghalaya. And strange as you may find it, a person of my privilege has faced a lot of discrimination in the Northeast. So I've been in the receiving end. Because in Shillong, if you are not a rival, you are referred to as a Dakar. You guys can possibly just revise your civics and history knowledge a little bit there. But Dakar essentially means an outsider. Now that entire identity is so strongly germinated within me that I want to identify myself as a local there. So I started dressing like Northeastern and I said I am a localite. People can see this. The facial features don't represent the Northeast side. And then I ask exact story in this particular you guys face outside. So please prevent that. For over 20 years, I was almost internalized in Northeastern. Then I moved to Delhi, as a journalist. And because I internalized the Northeastern so strongly, that here I started telling people I'm Northeastern. Now, why did I tell people I'm Northeastern? Because in Northeast, I didn't want people to call me an outsider. I was in Delhi, and I started telling people I'm from the Northeast. And guess the consequence? Outsider. I'm like, you know, what kind of local identity is this? So I'm like, yahan pe kaun sa syllabus chal raha hai? So people said, here, UP, Bihar, Delhi, and North India sounds like insiders. So I am not North India. Other than anybody is right. So for 3 years, I tried to play that North India from UP and from UP. And everybody is like, ah, how come Mali jaisa ho? 3 years later, I moved to Bombay.
I think you guys
are the person. Person from the north in Mumbai. just like the current government dispensation, just like the current government which treats your ability to speak, that love for your ability to speak. People in Maharashtra have a certain degree of love for people from there. My best friend was the auto wala there.
I just realized one of the nice people are from the north and from the north and from the north.
I feel like I'm not a part of the country. And they face a lot of discrimination. And I said, how do I tell this story? But they become a soft story in particular way. So I decided to form 4 minutes to share the comedy video on that. I don't believe this. Pretty much like the US Senate, a couple of days ago, US saw Ford and Kavanaugh selling that video. When some conversations just spoke a lot of bad memories, that video tended to soak a lot of bad memories among people saying this has happened in us as well. Then you open the newspaper, you see news of random things. In Bangalore, a person from the northeast was killed because he was using more water than what was required. Somebody in Delhi was killed because he had brown hair. I mean, this is our own country. This is fairly weird. Right now, this sounds like a political campaign, but hold. The next video that I came up with was on women empowerment. And I'll again tell you, it's just not because I wanted to sound extremely amazing and I wanted to say, wanted to have the support of feminists and everybody else, you know, coming to my foray. It's primarily because being in the North, I've seen women in my peers, in my circles, in my families undergo a sense of discrimination. I remember cracking this joke in Haryana. I'd gone to Haryana and I said, I landed in Haryana and Apple phone pe Siri stopped working. So I called up Siri, I called up Apple, and I told them Siri kaam nahi kar rahi hai. So they're like, kaun sa version use kar rahe hai? I said female version. The guy says, oh shit. I'm like, what happened? Technical glitch. He says, no, cultural glitch. It is weird. Somebody from the ruling government, again I'll not take names, retweeted that with a picture saying women have marked themselves safe in Gurgaon. And then sir, wo earthquake hua tha. Isme women have marked themselves safe. So the case is, these is, you know, cases of domestic violence won't happen in Gurgaon anymore. His inference was that women are safe now. I'm like, domestic violence doesn't take place because men are lazy. That is the reality of Gurgaon. So I made a joke on that and everybody was like, no, you go, what are you? Are you male or female? I'm like, huh? You will not believe this. On my Facebook profile, there's a picture of me as a child. And I must confess to everybody watching that I was far cuter as a child, okay? Don't validate that. I'm assuming I'm cute even now. As a kid, I don't have no idea. I think my mom was trying to live a childhood dream. I had a ponytail which was this long. So this guy from Haryana actually takes up that picture and starts making it go viral on WhatsApp. He's saying, "Ye to ladki hai." I had to have a serious conversation with my girlfriend to tell her, no, we are in a heterosexual relationship. Crazy sometimes. So these are largely some of the threads of the background stories that stand-up comedians use to weave in a sense of humor to articulate what everybody in society largely realizes. I was traveling by an airline, I can't take the name because this is a TEDx talk, but it was airline pe air officer support market. I think you guys would have got a sense. So sitting in the aircraft, and I saw somebody be very rude to somebody. Yeah, the air officer was being very rude to me because I asked for a bottle of water. Just pani ki bina. I'm like, chahiye. Like 35,000 feet pe pyaas sakti hai. So this air officer just refused to give me water. And I was like, how do I now find? Do I go to their Twitter handle and tweet? Now don't tell them, but I can't tweet Air India, right? It's really weird. I decided to use that for content. I'm like, funny, mila, koi baat hi content mila. So I made a fictional story saying that once I was sitting in an Air India flight and there's a woman sitting on the front seat और उसके हाथ में एक छोटा सा बच्चा है आप पेपर क्लियरेंस के टाइम पे एक महिला आती है देर से ऐसे सर बेटा पेपर कब दे दो तो बच्चे तो नादान होते हैं बच्चे ने कहा नहीं दूंगा उसने कहा बेटा पेपर कब दे दो उसने कहा नहीं दूंगा बेटा पेपर कब दे दो उसने कहा नहीं दूंगा तो तेरा सर ने छीन के डंप कर दिया बच्चे को Now I wanted to share my own harrowing experience about Air India. I thought that is the best way. She didn't give me water, but that video has given me a million plus views. Again, this is the point that I generally get in the blog, but he is learning 100 views because I'm perfect. If I can get this from you guys. Those are cases of me just joking, guys. And therefore, every time I'm just joking, there's a larger story that's playing in the background as a narrative. But I must confess, with the current dispensation in the country, I don't really know what's joking and what's not joking. In Madhya Pradesh, two frogs were made to marry each other. You guys read the story? They thought that if two beings sambhog karenge, toh bachcha ka problem solve ho jayega. Exactly at that point in time, Section 377 was in discussion. And the current government said, we are against homosexuality. I was like, great idea. The two frogs who married to each other were males. I'm like, at least practice what you preach. There is a chief minister somewhere in the Northeast. I was on performing in the Northeast and somebody said, you are the funniest stand-up comedian from the Northeast. I said, have you heard the chief minister of Tripura? I cannot tell you the degree of hate I got on my Facebook page. I suddenly became a viral sensation in the Northeast. So the guy in the Northeast who said, I respected you, but now I'll change you to Pakistan and bite me. I said, I understand the effort you take to go from the Northeast to North India, to the Pakistan border, cross into enemy territory and bite me. Who are you? A dog. So then this whole community got really angry and I had to apologize to the dog community. Narrative there, okay. Again, as far as just joking is concerned, so as I said, that generally when stand-up comedians perform on stage, don't just go by what they say. In fact, a lot of people get offended by stand-up comedians cracking jokes, it's because they don't realize that there's an experience behind narrating that story for most of us, yeah? Unless you're in a relationship. Yeah? People in relationships, give me a morning cheer. Morning cheer, generally. I sometimes don't understand if my girlfriend is just joking or not just joking. Genuinely, every time she makes a mistake, I apologize. And then she says, you don't mean it. How can the apology have layers? For people in relationships, let me give an advice. If you have had your girlfriend make a mistake and she has apologized to you, do not count it as a victory. Girlfriends are like Lannisters in Game of Thrones. They will repay their debt. With GST. But there's one last element I want to touch upon before going from stage here. As performing artists, okay? There's a sense of expectation that people have, which is very weird. And I'll share a little bit about this. People feel that because you're a stand-up comedian, there's a sense of humor that you have, right? And therefore people reach out to you for solutions to problems which you have never really dealt with. I remember once on my Facebook page, I got a message from a girl. She said, and she narrated an ordeal, a terrible experience she's had in high school. And she said, I'm still writing to you, I'm not expecting a response. I just want to know if you can tell me a joke and make me feel good. Because I'm feeling suicidal right now. And trust me, all my ambitions as a stand-up comedian, every little thing that I read about in the art of stand-up comedy, that is a moment that I was speechless. I'm fairly sure that lady was not just joking. As performing artists, it's a duty at some level to represent every section of the society. And I think if society starts seeing our jokes and our work as not just joking but something behind that, maybe a greater degree of sensitivity will come into play. Yeah. I want to leave you guys with just one last message that I have a flight to catch in Bombay. To Bombay. And if I don't leave now, possibly you guys will have to be here for a longer way, you know, duration of time. Which may not be the best idea. Yeah. So thank you very much. You guys have been a brilliant audience.